Okay, so let's make a start. My name is Mike Savage. I'm head of the Department of Sociology here at the LSC, and I'm also going to be chairing this discussion about the new forms of cultural capital. I am going to say a few words and show a few slides at the outset to set the debate going, but the three main contributors are sitting on the table here, and they'll each come up and speak for about 10 or 15 minutes. And the main, in some ways, the main reason why we're here today is to take advantage of the visit of Professor Philippe Coulangeon from Sciences Po, who's been visiting the LSE for the last month, and he's going to be talking about some of his work on new forms of cultural capital. But also alongside him, we have Sam Friedman, who's a colleague in the Department of Sociology at the LSE, and Laurie Hanquinet, who's visiting from University of York. So this is a really quite distinguished panel. Because I'm chairing it, I'm not going to be answering any questions, but I will point the questions to people who might be able to answer them. And the other thing I should say at the beginning is that Philippe has to catch the Eurostar at just before 8 o'clock, so he's going to be leaving slightly early. So any questions towards him should come in the early part of the discussion. Okay, so as I said, I'm chairing it rather than speaking, but I thought, given this is an area which interests me, I should say a few words about the overarching concerns of this session, which, although they may seem quite specialised, actually touch on really key issues of debate now in the social sciences, and I think will interest a broad audience. And I'm showing a series of books and journals which have recently, in the last couple of years or less, been exploring the idea that there are new forms of cultural capital which are working in contemporary societies. And I'll say a bit more about cultural capital in a minute, but they include, firstly, on the left-hand side, the handbook by myself and Laurie Hanquinet, which is an international handbook bringing together over 40 contributions from scholars across the world looking at issues around analysing, measuring, and conceptualising cultural capital. We also have a book which was edited by Philippe over here in the middle. It's gone blank, but the blue one, The Routledge Companion to Bourdieu's Distinction, which came out of a major conference in Paris several years ago, which provided a great chance to evaluate the significance of Bourdieu's thinking 30 years on. The journal Poetics is one of the world's leading journals in cultural sociology, and it has a forthcoming issue, edited by myself and Laurie and Sam, on new forms of distinction. Finally, Sam Friedman, who will be speaking in a minute, had a recent book out on forms of comedy, and any of you who have been looking at this new book, which I and Sam have been involved with on social class, will see the idea of emerging cultural capital as one of the sub-themes of the book. So a number of different currents are coming through here, and the aim of tonight is to try and take stock of those currents. Okay, just a few words before I pass on to the panel. Many of you who I guess have come here will know about the term cultural capital. You'll have heard of Bourdieu, and you're probably familiar in some extent with his arguments in distinction. The point which we all want to emphasise is that that account was developed a long time ago, based upon empirical work carried out in the 1960s in France. It was conducted at a time when only half of French households had a TV set, and we were a long way from the internet, Google, and all those things. So this is a very different moment, and the undercurrent for our rethinking of cultural capitalists is to say, well, can we still use the same account of cultural capital today, which Bourdieu developed 50 or so years ago? Worth saying a few words about what Bourdieu was claiming about cultural capital. He emphasised that there was a kind of historical canon of cultural excellence, going back to the Enlightenment or before, which defined high culture, highbrow cultural capital. Is that still the same in today's fast-moving contemporary world? He developed this notion of the Kantian aesthetic as a means of understanding what cultural capital meant. And the argument here was that forms of cultural value and cultural distinction depended upon removing yourself from the everyday world, the humdrum world of getting by, and it demanded being a kind of intellectual, distant from the principles of necessity. Famously, Bourdieu argued that economic capital and cultural capital had separate, what could be found separately. So you had some people who were intellectuals, who didn't have much economic capital, and some who were industrialists, who didn't have much cultural capital. He doesn't say much about age and gender, which today might seem significant. And you can also argue that the distinction is premised upon the salience of national or perhaps European frames of reference. So all these things underpin his work, but can be contested today. And you don't need to understand this diagram. This is a famous diagram from his book. But it tries to give an account of cultural capital in France in the 1960s, which emphasizes two main distinctions. The vertical distinction on the y-axis, which distinguishes people with lots of cultural capital at the top from those without cultural capital, from those without cultural economic capital at the bottom. And then this composition principle on the x-axis, the horizontal axis, which situates people with economic capital, someone on the left and someone on the right, and cultural capital on the left. This is the kind of classic model you find in much of Bourdieu's work. We don't need to get into the details here, but the issue is this a good framework for thinking about culture today? And a number of us, all of us in this table, have explored the idea that this model, although we're still very wedded to the notion of cultural capital in general, we think that we need to rethink how to measure it, how to analyse it, and how to conceptualise it. And these list of bullet points indicate the issues which we think are posed by current trends. Firstly, can we still talk about the historical canon of culture? Are we still these days influenced by the legacy coming from the Enlightenment, from Shakespeare, from the classical tradition, or not? How lively and how important is that domain of cultural life these days? Just to give a flavour of some of the issues here, when you ask people about music, a few years ago, myself and some colleagues asked about musical taste, people knew about Beethoven, they knew about Mozart, they knew about Bach, but they rarely got excited about them. They got excited about contemporary things. And if that's true, where does that leave the link back to historical forms of cultural capital? Secondly, in Bourdieu's writing, there's very little about ethnicity, gender, age as dimensions of cultural taste, but today, these issues are highly significant in various kinds of ways, as we'll see in the discussion to come. How do we give these more of a significant register in understanding cultural life? And finally, how do we take into account a set of tastes which straddle national borders? In Bourdieu's model of distinction, he asked French people about their tastes for all sorts of things, but they were nearly all the tastes or the cultural works produced by French people. And there was very little questioning about art or culture or literature from Africa or America, even from the UK, actually. Can we do that these days in the world of the internet, musical streaming, and the diversity of cultural tastes? Arguably not. So how do we conceptualise the cosmopolitanisation of cultural tastes? My final slide to set the scene is, over the last 3 or 4 years, one way of conceptualising a means of updating Bourdieu's approach is this concept of emerging cultural capital. And the argument here, put simply, is that there are forms of cultural capital linked to younger people, younger, well-educated people, which are different in fundamental ways from those associated with older people. And there's therefore a very big emphasis upon the age and generational divisions in cultural capital. To give you an example, well, if any of you go to classical music concerts, you will know that it's really, really rare. I don't expect you do, look at the age of you in this audience, but if you do, it's really rare to find people under the age of 40 at a classical music concert. The average age now at the BBC Radio 3, which is the classical music station, is about 65 years old. There's an aging out of that kind of high cultural capital. And the younger audiences appear to be interested in other kinds of things. Playing sports, listening to rap music, going to rock concerts, playing on the internet, being on Facebook, Twitter, or whatever. So there's arguably a generational shift taking place. Arguably, this is arguable, but at least on the face of it, a shift taking place in how younger people are deploying cultural capital these days. Secondly, the Kantian aesthetic was about distancing yourself from the day-to-day. Cultural excellence depended upon standing back from everyday life, standing back from kind of, you know, routine activities and being intellectual, taking an abstract point of view, thinking about things in a way which valued abstract art, non-representational forms of culture. But today, arguably, there's much more focus upon getting involved, doing things, playing sport, you know, being on Twitter, being on Facebook, doing things, rather than detachment. And thirdly, again, another argument to pursue is the idea that today elite culture, even elite culture, has changed its nature. So rather than elite culture being defined by the historical, canonical, highbrow, even elite culture is now characterized by new and dynamic and emerging forms of cultural capital. In which case, even the kind of the high camp, the kind of fortress of cultural capital is being remade. So those are the issues. Can we still talk about cultural capital? Perhaps we can, perhaps we can't, but is the idea of emerging cultural capital a useful way, a useful framework for understanding the way forward and conceptualizing these things better? So that's me setting the scene. I'm going to pass on to Philippe, who will give the first talk.
Thank you. I just... how does it work? Yes. Okay. Thank you for inviting me in this very exciting round table. I will just try to build on my preliminary remarks and try to illustrate this idea of emerging cultural capital in the context of contemporary France. I will do that with a specific focus on what I will call the cosmopolitan cultural resources, which I think are of growing importance in contemporary French society, which are more and more divisive and cleaving in the French context. I will then question more generally the impact of these emerging forms of cultural capital on inequality. In recent years, the mixing of cultural repertoires, the blurring of the boundaries between highbrow and lowbrow culture, the emergence of new cultural assets have sometimes been viewed as a sign of a kind of cultural democratization. Here, my contention is that these emerging forms of cultural capital are not necessarily more equally distributed than the more established one, and that the kind of cultural dispositions that go along with this kind of emerging cultural forms of cultural capital are not at all exclusive of some form of symbolic exclusion or domination. Well, concerning my first point, I will present here some very preliminary results of an ongoing research, mainly based on a multi-correspondence analysis made on the data of the 2008 French survey on French cultural practices. In this analysis, I took into consideration three groups of variables. First, variables related to participation in highbrow culture, books, owning and reading, attendance to theater, opera, etc. A second group of variables that relate to participation in media culture, time spent on TV, preferred TV channels and programs, etc. and a third group of variables that relate to the participation in cosmopolitan culture, reading of foreign books, watching of foreign TV channels, travels, taste in arts work from abroad, etc. The basic result of the analysis can be displayed in the map of the two first factors of this multi-correspondence analysis. Basically, the first axis, the horizontal axis, correspond by and large to a size factor or a volume factor that contrasts on the left side of this horizontal axis, people with a lot of cultural assets, especially a lot of hybrid cultural assets, but not exclusively. And on the other side of the axis, people that are basically deprived of many, if not all, of these cultural assets, except from watching television. So I think this very classical results can be completed by the examination of the vertical, the second axis, that contrasts what I call local and global cultural assets. The second axis is mainly structured by the opposition of established cultural items and cultural items that are rooted in the national cultural context, and on the top of the axis, cultural items that are more representative of emergent form of cultural capital, and more precisely, that are more representative of cosmopolitan cultural capital, reading a foreign book, mastery of foreign languages, watching TV program in foreign language, etc. If I had time, I could also demonstrate by the projection of some supplementary variable in this map that in the northwest quadrant of I don't know how it functions. So in the northwest quadrant of the map, I could show that that is precisely the area of the map where the boundary between eyebrow and mass culture is the much more imprecise than in the other area of the map. So when projecting some social demographic characteristics on this map as supplementary variables, we see that it is really not a very surprising result that the first axis, the horizontal axis, is highly structured by class and education, contrasting on the left side of the panel people that are the most educated, people from upper classes, higher grad professional and managers, and on the right side, people that who are the less educated and people from working classes, manual workers, non-manual routine workers, etc. Well, turning to my second point, the question is whether the emerging form of cultural capital in general, that the second axis of my analysis illustrates, I think. The point here is to consider if this emerging form of cultural capital go along or not with a decrease in cultural inequalities. My general impression concerning many of the emerging form of cultural capital that we are talking about this afternoon is that, in a sense, this emergence of new form of cultural capital disturb a little the process of cultural reproduction, disturb in a sense the process of cultural domination that generally underlie class relation. In other terms, the bad news for the dominant, to borrow the terms of Bourdieu, is that these emerging forms of cultural capital are probably a little more difficult to transmit than the more conventional one, because they are more generationally differentiated, because they are more uncertain and more changing, because they are less strongly related to established cultural and educational institutions. And so they probably require a more uncertain and difficult work of transmission. But this bad news for the dominant does not mean good news for the dominated. The second point is that the bad news for the dominated is that these emerging forms of symbolic domination based on more flexible boundaries between cultural repertoires, based on this kind of irony, knowingness of described by, here by many of my colleagues at this table, this aptitude to be at ease with various sort of cultural items, to speak like Chamuscan. Perhaps all this disposition, all these items, all this form of cultural domination are perhaps more difficult to challenge precisely because they are less anchored in established cultural and educational institutions, and that there, and for that reason there is probably less opportunity to challenge the domination by means, for example, of education. So if I briefly come back to my analysis on French data, here what I did in this graph is only projecting the modalities of a variable which is made of the cross-tabulation of age and class. And what we see here is that the relative distance between higher grade professional and manager and non-manual and a manual worker are roughly the same for people age 30 or less and for people age 70 or less. There is no evidence of a generational decrease of the cultural distance between classes. The only thing is that there is perhaps an increasing distance between the top of the class hierarchy, higher grad professional and managers, and the intermediate level, lower grad professional. It is much more visible if we do the same kind of thing by crossing age and education. No, not any reduction, not any decrease of cultural distance between less educated and more educated on the whole, but an increasing distance, perhaps, between those at the top of the educational hierarchies, people with at least 3 years of universities, and those with an intermediate level of education, say people with up to 2 years of university. And I think that it's a result that could be investigated a little more. So I will just conclude with three remarks about the kind of thing that I think need to be investigated in this field of cultural, of emerging form of cultural capital. I think that we need to investigate a little more the question of transmission and conversion of this emerging form of cultural capital, which definitely are this form of transmission and conversion are really different, I think, from the transmission and conversion, the process of transmission and conversion of the more established one. We need to investigate the relation between emerging cultural capital and education, where the notion of cultural capital was originally coined. A lot of research about the emerging form of cultural capital displays the fact that the emerging form of cultural capital play a role in social life, but it's not totally evident that they play a role in education, especially education of very young pupils. At least it's a thing that needs to be investigated. And last, I think we need to investigate this emerging form of cultural capital in comparative perspective, because I think that the different national contexts are very different in that respect. Well, I cannot finish without thanking Mike and all the members of the Department of Sociology for the very warm reception here at the LSE during these 4 weeks. It has really been a very pleasant period of time, a pleasant period that brutally ended on Friday night. And tonight, I just hope that there will be other periods like this 4 weeks in the future. Thank you for all.
Thank you, Philippe. Now on to Sam Friedman.
Okay. I want to just do two things with my slot. First, I'm going to briefly explain and introduce a case study, I suppose, of emerging cultural capital from my work on British comedy taste. And then I want to push the concept a little further and think about how we might research how emerging cultural capital is actually expressed. How is it actually deployed in everyday life? So, my study of British comedy spanned 5 years, from 2008 to 2013. It took place at the Edinburgh Festival Fringe. For those of you who don't know, that's the largest comedy festival in the world. And I think comedy is interesting because historically it's very much been considered a lowbrow art form. Its lineage is in working class music hall, in early television sitcom, 1970s trad, stand-up, etc. But in the 1980s, a group of comedians initiated what came to be known as the alternative comedy movement. And this really introduced more critical, more political, more intellectual forms of stand-up, which have subsequently come to become very established genres in their own right, that really jostle for space alongside these more traditional forms. So I wanted to look at how those changes in the production of British comedy had affected the consumption of comedy. So in my study, I first used MCA, which was the method that Philippe was just showing you there, to look at taste for a range of different British stand-ups and television comedies. And what I found was really striking. The most powerful taste division separates upper middle class respondents in my study, particularly younger generations, which I think is important, who tended to prefer a set of clearly critically acclaimed comedians. Okay, these were people like Stuart Lee, TV comedies like Brass Eye and The Thick of It. From a set of working class respondents, particularly older generations, who tended to prefer a set of much less critically acclaimed comedians. Okay, these were people like Roy Chubby Brown and Jim Davidson. And this taste division is important, I argue, in the book, because it both contributes to and reflects the construction of these certain comedians as special cultural objects, okay? Tastes that in and of themselves communicate a sense of Borgesian cultural distinction. But I think the interesting thing to say about comedy, really, is really that most of the comedy in my survey, most of the comedy that I asked about, was actually liked across the spectrum, okay? It was crossover, if you might say. But for this, for me, this really underlined, I suppose, a limitation of trying to understand emerging forms of cultural capital solely through survey analysis. While questionnaires can tell you what culture people like, it really can't tell you very much about why they like what they do. And this is really when I interviewed people that I found to be the most important sort of class divide in the UK. It was through the expression of a particular sense of humour that my upper middle class respondents in particular seemed to most aggressively set themselves apart. For these respondents, comedy should never be just funny, okay? It should never centre purely around the creation of laughter. Instead, good comedy should have meaning, okay? Whether this is a political message or an experiment with form. Either way, the consumer should have to work for their laughter, okay? And in there was a sense that through doing so, one was able to sort of reach the higher plane of comic appreciation, to really get the joke in its entirety. And I think the power of this particular sense of humour, this style of appreciation for comedy, is it seemed to give my respondents a sense, or certainly that they felt, that they could express distinction through the consumption of almost any comic object. And this was actually demonstrated by, I suppose, discussions of those crossover comedians, the Eddie Izzards, the Jimmy Carrs, the Simon Amstels. These stand-ups in the survey were liked by nearly all my respondents, but I was amazed by the insistence of more middle-class respondents in interviews that they could get more from this kind of comedy. They were able to extract what Melanie there said as a whole other level of humour. Now, one key thing, I suppose, that emerges from this work is that while measuring people's orientation to legitimate cultural objects may provide important clues about cultural capital, this kind of analysis, I think, is becoming markedly less useful, particularly if we really want to tap this idea of emerging cultural capital. Instead, for me, at least, the focus of empirical research needs to sort of go the other way. It needs to go in an ethnographic direction to look at two things. First, I think there needs to be more work on the nature of the dominant aesthetic. What is it that when people talk about culture, others recognize as a sense of authority, as a sense of sophistication? What precisely is in that expression that makes it dominant, legitimate, etc.? And second, I think it's important to look at how that notion of a dominant or a legitimate aesthetic is actually translated into expressions of taste and actually deployed in everyday interactions. Now, just to give you a very brief example of what I have in mind here, I want to introduce you to a respondent from a paper I'm currently working on. This is Benedict. He was a 38-year-old, it's not his real name, of course. He's a senior IT consultant and perhaps a sort of poster boy, I would suggest, for emerging cultural capital. He tells me he has strong interest in high art, traditional high art, particularly visual art and literature. But in our discussions, it's notable that Benedict is much more animated when discussing pop music, okay? He is unapologetic, he tells me, about having what he calls a pop sensibility. But at the same time, he is clearly looking for a certain type of popular music, a combination, he says, of originality and familiarity, something which is conventional, but also a little unhinged. And the perfect example of this complex aesthetic match, he explains in our interview, is the American synth pop band, The Future Islands, okay? And this is a quote from him there. He says, it's fairly conventional, but the singer's got a very unusual vocal style. He's really odd. He's got these two registers, falsetto and quite deep, but at the same time, just enough of a normal pop sensibility. Now, I was really struck by not just the confidence that underpinned Benedict's aesthetic style, but also the sort of transmissibility of this aesthetic, the way he readily applied it across the cultural spectrum. So probing further, he explained to me, I suppose it's about the choices you make in almost any situation. Whenever the opportunity is there to make a choice between doing one thing or another, eating some sort of food or the other, there tends to be thought behind it, operating principles. It's not arbitrary, it's thought about. For example, we don't like McDonald's, that's that kind of fast food, but we would choose Burger King over McDonald's. So everything, the band, everything, you know, there's nothing that escapes scrutiny. So for me, this is really the perfect example of emerging cultural capital in action. Both refusing to refuse, okay, any sort of form of popular culture, but at the same time being sort of exhaustingly selective and detailed in the decisions one makes in terms of consumption. But I want to just finish with one important caveat in relation to Benedict. While his sense of certainty in the value of his own taste is really quite clear, what was interesting to me is that he's actually very careful, even calculating, about when and to whom he actually expresses this sensibility in public. So having just told me about the operating principles of his taste, he paused before noting, but some people do find it annoying. And I do want to retain that connection, because you work in an organization like I do with people from cleaners to the principal, and some people are very good at talking vertically or communicating vertically. And I asked, do you think you're good at that? And he said, I'm not as good as I used to be, but I try. I mean, it's how you appear to others, isn't it? So I think it's partly about the performative. Yeah, wanting to establish a sort of zero base. So there's a persona that I want to project, which is more, you know, I've got it quite well. You experiment with different approaches, but ultimately it's performative. So I suppose my tentative suggestion, and I don't really have enough time to develop this argument here, is that part of the knowingness of emerging cultural capital may not just be about employing a particular aesthetic disposition, but also about applying a certain reflexive social disposition, a capacity, if you will, to monitor one's presentation of self, to know when to accentuate cultural difference, but also to know when to downplay difference. And here I'm thinking of a sort of Goffmanian idea of front stage, backstage selves. Especially, I think, and this is important, in a contemporary environment where morally a too naked expression of cultural distinction can actually backfire as a signal of smugness, or as a signal of snobbery, or as a signal of elitism. Okay, I'll leave it there.
Thank you, Sam. Now we're moving on to Laurie Hanquinet.
Right. Hello. I'm going to make a presentation somewhat more theoretical, so I hope you won't mind. I just want to explore the link between highbrow culture and cultural capital, and you will see there is a link with emerging form of cultural capital. I believe it's actually trying to assess the link between cultural capital and highbrow culture is actually a very useful exercise in order to assess the theoretical value of one, omnivorousness, and second, emerging form of cultural capital. And I have three a more precise question in mind. First, I wanted to ask whether we actually need hyperculture when we talk about cultural capital. And this is mainly because in the sociology of education, for instance, they have some scholars have argued that we don't need the notion of hyperaesthetic culture to account for cultural capital. And in that case, cultural capital just become a skill, a competence, some knowledge. So it becomes very vague in a sense. And linked to that, so if let's imagine that we want to keep hybrid culture related to culture capitals. The second question is, what does hybrid culture mean in our current cultural context, which has been called omnivorous or eclectic, more eclectic than before? And then this will enable me to then assess the theoretical value of the omnivore and the idea of the idea of emerging culture capital. So does embedded cultural capital need hybriculture to be defined? So basically, I will argue yes, because if you think about culture capital is based on the idea of accumulation of resources, which was, in Bourdieu's mind, led by different aesthetic principles, and I think Mike have already discussed that when he talked about the Kantian aesthetic, for instance. But there is a but. Hybriculture can not only actually be related to a hybrid aesthetic à la Bourdieu anymore. So what I mean by the hybrid aesthetic à la Bourdieu is an aesthetic that virulate that privileged form of a matter, which will privilege a distant relation to art and etc. So nowadays, this specific way to approach culture and art has changed. Cultural producers and consumers have increasingly embraced a new aesthetic criteria that could be called postmodernist, for instance. But these new criteria challenge the separation from the commercial and the popular culture and endorses a more playful aesthetic based on experimentation. So there are the changes in what is aesthetically and socially refined can explain the emergence of the well-known figure of the omnivore. And the omnivore is someone who is keen to engage with different forms of high, middle, and low-brow cultures. So yes, we're going to keep hybriculture, or at least I will keep it. But then what does it mean nowadays? And I think we need to remember one thing. We need to remember that omnivore are people who take their very specific status, their privileged status come from the fact that they cross specific and persisting boundaries. So really, omnivores need hybrid culture to remain in place. So they need the tension between hybrid and low-brow culture, but they will cross that tension, and by crossing that tension, they will actually draw new social boundaries. So that's the first point, really. Omnivorousness is a mechanism that feeds on the distinction between hybrid and low-brow culture, but also between younger and older forms of culture, rather than destroying them. And I think Philippe has already mentioned the tension between the older and the younger. The second one is I want also to say that we can argue that hybriculture has become somewhat more inclusive. So I've already mentioned the fact that there are new aesthetic criteria. There are new forms of being aesthetic refinement. And if you think, for instance, about Diamond Earth, his work is quite a good example of these new aesthetic forms. But I'm quite more interested here in what I have called the hybrid byproduct of popular culture. And it's quite important to look into to see that there are a hierarchy within cultural genres, within popular cultural genres. So you have a tension between good, refined, sophisticated popular culture versus the bad, the unsophisticated popular culture. And I quite like the example that Johnston and Bowman has given about the gourmet burger. So the burger was historically just a classic working class dish. And now it has become something more, can be a bit more hybrid if you take the gourmet burger with Kobe beef, special bread, and so on and so on. So this is a way that the upper classes have actually managed to use popular culture for their own means. You also have a very good paper by Regev where it shows how people have tried to make rock serious, to make it something quite a serious art and try to change the rhetorics around it. So basically, you can argue that hybrid culture has become more inclusive because it has used some forms of popular culture, but in a way, some forms of hybrid popular culture. And also, the last point in my argumentation for this question is there are also distinctive ways to be omnivores. So you can like many things, but you will like them in a specific way. And Sam has just given you the example of comedy, where people from different classes can like a similar comedian, a similar show, but they won't appreciate it in a similar way. And you can actually develop some sort of rhetoric that make you look highbrow. You will like a show because it's smart, because it's socially reflexive, and so on and so on. So all of this to say that basically the omnivore is not a real challenger. And omnivores has never challenged the existence of hybrid culture, but reflects the fact that hybrid culture has become more inclusive. And what is socially and aesthetically valorized by those with high cultural capital has been updated to reflect wider cultural and social changes. But omnivores then, sort of being eclectic, crossing boundaries between high and low brow culture, omnivores appear to be simply the empirical manifestation of this process rather than the cause. So this apparent eclecticism doesn't mean the end of cultural hierarchies, but rather a more complex structuration of cultural capital, and which includes disposition to appreciate established, but also more emerging cultural forms. So in that sense, we need to understand that cultural capital can have a floating meaning and that we need to update its meaning to take into account that the field of cultural productions evolves, change, new criteria come forward. And this is very in line with the historical nature of Bourdieu's habitus, who really, according to Bourdieu, the habitus absorb contextual transformation and process them into new disposition. So in short, emerging people who have actually worked, the contribution of those who are working on emerging forms of cultural capital has been essential because they help us to rethink the reconfiguration of the configuration of cultural capital as structuration. It shows that new cultural items... Oh, they don't want me to speak anymore. Okay, how do I do that? Do you have an idea of how that worked? I have just one slide left, but... Well, basically, new stuff have happened. So new cultural items and aesthetic criteria have progressively become valorized, but they are not symbolically accessible to all, so new forms of distinction appear. These new resources have not seriously questioned the link between hybrid and cultural capital, but we can actually suggest that there are different kinds of of hybrid culture. There are different ways to relate to hybrid culture. And different kinds of hybrid culture, which can take a more classic and a more contemporary outlook. Thank you.
Thank you, Laurie. So I think you'll see these three different presentations all exploring the ways in which cultural hierarchies and cultural capital are being remade, but also in some ways staying the same. So how we can see forms of cultural hierarchy is being reconstructed, even on the basis of contemporary changes. Okay, we have about half an hour for any questions or comments from the floor. Who would like to start?
Hi, thank you very much for those very interesting presentations. I was just wondering what role, if any, do you think that government policy plays in cultural capital? For example, the UK has the Department for Culture, Media, and Sport, and do you think it should play a role?
Okay. Are there any more questions before we ask for responses, one over there, I think? Okay.
Hi. Thank you very much for the interesting presentations. I wondered if any of the panelists could say a little bit more about something that was mentioned at the start by Mike Savage about the importance of sort of the contemporary in shaping cultural capital, so the importance of cultural exposure to, exposure to different cultures and international experience and volunteering and all of these things. And in what way does that set up new forms of distinction? And in a way, is that a kind of, could it be a kind of deadlock in terms of that, you know, we're all trying to do it, but who actually gets to do it in a way that's distinguishing from the other types of experience? So where are the kind of thresholds there? Because it seems to be a kind of ubiquitous way of distinguishing yourself. And I know that's a contradiction, but I thought that might be interesting to talk about that as well.
Two good questions. Shall we get some... Is there one more? Stage? There's one more down there, yeah.
Hello. Thanks very much for the presentations. I work in education access and social mobility, and I'm thinking about these presentations through the lens of education and what should be taught to children, and trying to put some value on culture and therefore trying to prioritise things within a curriculum. I was struck by your presentation, Sam, by a question, which is it that the appreciation of perhaps what could be called established forms of culture inform this other level that you can get from emerging forms of culture? So is there perhaps no real or no significant value in emerging culture except that can be added by knowing established forms of culture? And I wonder whether the other panellists would be interested in commenting on that.
Great, three good, really good questions. So who would like to start, my panel members? Sam?
Yeah, I mean, I'll maybe start with the last question, which is a crucial question in a way, and it's sort of, I was talking to Philippe before the talk today about the importance of education in all of this, and I suppose it also talks to the question a little bit about policy. I think that in terms of, it's difficult to know what the relation, I mean, in the sense that it's not been empirically examined, when people are sort of ranging around these sort of different cultural forms, what has gone first, and it would seem a sort of logical assumption that in the way me and Philippe were talking about earlier, you almost have to know the rules, i.e. you've sort of learnt didactically the canon, perhaps in your school, to then be able to feel confident enough to play with the rules in terms of ranging then into, you know, a ironic or knowing appreciation of particular popular cultural forms. But I would say that is an empirical question that would have to be sort of looked at in some depth. But I think it's interesting. I'm not sure how important that those sort of established forms are. I'm not sure I would feel confident that everything is sort of flowing still from a base knowledge. And I mean, your sort of initial thought was around sort of access, and she's here. I suppose the, as Philippe was saying, perhaps the scariest thing about when you link process of emerging cultural capital inequality is precisely because you can't necessarily identify objects that it's associated with. It's harder to challenge. And so in terms of sort of access or equalizing access to emerging cultural capital so that it doesn't necessarily have this role in perpetuating inequality, I think that would be a real challenge and has to be more about, you know, how you look rather than what you're looking at. I would imagine it's something about this idea of confidence that comes with your right to speak about cultural value, about the your sense that your taste has value. And I don't know if that's something that can be sort of embedded in an educational context. I don't know. Sorry.
Do you want to go? Yep.
Yes, I would like to react to the comments about cultural policy and about education too. About cultural policy in the French context, there has been during the last 20 or 30 years real debate in terms of doctrinal controversy in the realm of cultural policies between the conception of cultural policy in terms of democratization of the canon and an alternative form of cultural policy, which is more elaborated in terms of cultural democracy. That is the idea that the role of public policy is not to impose the cultural canon, but to give the same kind of opportunity to the diversity of existing cultural repertoires in the society. Well, this controversy seems to me quite theoretical, because in reality, when you look at the budgets, when you look at the French, to take the example of France, French cultural policy remains highly defined in terms of democratization of the established cultural canon. So I think that the question we are talking about are clearly related in that sense with question of cultural policy, because we all know that this old model of cultural democratization has failed, and that probably we should reframe cultural policies much more in terms of cultural democracy, at least in order to taking into account the fact that new cultural assets appear that are relevant and which unequal distribution has social consequences. But in reality, I think that in the French context, at least, cultural policy remains highly defined in terms of cultural democratization. As to the question of the link between education and culture, education and cultural capital, yes, I was talking about that with Sam before the talk, and my impression is that, but it's perhaps my impression is misleading, but my impression is that a lot of example of emerging cultural capital that we are talking about this afternoon relate to cultural items, cultural assets that play the role in the structuring of symbolic relation between classes among adult people. But I'm not so sure that, at least today, this form of emerging cultural capital really plays a role as crucial as the more established established forms of cultural capital in the process of education, at least in the process of education, say at primary school, for example. If you look at university, I think it would be different. If we have in mind the wonderful book of Seamus Khan, Privilege, we see that there is something in the training of the elites today, which has something to do with this aptitude to manage this emerging form of cultural capital. But if we consider education as the process of educating young, very young pupils, I'm not totally sure that things are so changing. Sorry, I'm a bit too long.
I just wanted to add something about cultural policy. There is the same kind of thing in Belgium as well. So the issues around cultural democratization has been replaced by cultural democracy in try to respect different forms of culture, minority cultures, and etc. But in the UK, there has been a report recently by Miles and Sullivan in which they argue that the main tension in the UK, at least, is the tension between the culturally engaged and versus the culturally disengaged, and then we should focus on the policymakers should focus on everyday participation. I agree with that, but I also agree, but it's not very surprising given my talk, that we shouldn't forget that
that hybrid culture is not in decline, and that what we fund, actually the money, where the money goes is very important too, and we need to fund different forms of participation. So yeah, that's one answer to that. So please have a look at Miles and Sullivan paper. Also, I think I have a slightly different view about the tension between hybrid culture and emerging forms, so for more established and emerging forms of cultural capital. I do think that usually people who develop emerging form of capital are people who already have a strong background, cultural background, who have a strong cultural knowledge that they can actually use to transform something that was not edgy into something that is now edgy. So they have these skills to make something emerging as something that has some kind of value. So I do think established forms of culture and teaching established form of culture is still quite important in the production and reproduction of social stratification.
I can just add one thing there, abuse my brother chair. On the issue about what is contemporary about it, and also kind of the institutional structure of cultural taste, because I think this is crucial. It's kind of, we know descriptively that these patterns, and I mean, we've all looked at that in various ways, but it's kind of, can we see these as forms of privilege and power? I just want to share with you an anecdote, really, but perhaps it's an interesting one for my son, who's 16 years old, doing his GCSEs. In history, he is looking at the Weimar Republic and the rise of fascism, and he's looking at the Vietnam War and the rise of communism in China, i.e. nothing before 1914, but quite international, which is kind of quite interesting. I mean, he hasn't actually done any medieval history along the way. So what does that mean in terms of the stakes around the contemporary? And in English, he's doing two authors who are, I did Shakespeare when I was, in the usual stuff. Chaucer even was mentioned when I was doing my exams. He's doing Nick Hornby. For those of you who know him, he's a kind of middle-brow kind of novelist who writes about, alienated young boys and men. And J.B. Priestley, and you know him, a middle-brow, again, English novelist from the 1930s. Nothing going back for the 20th century. So I do think, actually, institutionally, even, we are seeing a reworking of the stakes of the contemporary in ways which are quite interesting and which don't necessarily value the kind of the traditional highbrow, but of course that's just an anecdote, but I thought I'd throw it in. Any more questions?
Is it on? Yes. Yeah. Thanks for an interesting talk. I was wondering if you could reflect a little bit more about a possible divide also between economic and cultural elite, because now all of you talk, of course, kind of a clear distinction between highbrow and lowbrow and omnivores, of course, but I wonder if you see any differences in that.
Okay, let's have two more.
Just sort of a follow-up to Mike's question there. You've all stated that you think highbrow culture is still very important in how we look at cultural capital. I wanted to ask you, do you think what we consider highbrow culture has changed, and particularly, say, the classical canon? So it might be a more theoretical question for Laurie, but also an empirical one for Philippe on sort of how has the cultural canon in France changed since Bourdieu's time, and what is the importance of that? Well, if it has changed, that is.
Okay, one more. The back there. The back. Oh. This is fine. Yeah.
Hi, thank you for the talk. Do you think that behind this refuse, as Dr. Friedman called it, but at the same time being somehow selective about what we like, so do you think behind this sort of contradiction there is a sort of sense of indecision of what we like nowadays? And to be a little more extreme, do you think that behind this sense of indecision, if there is any, well, this sense of indecision challenges the concept of cultural hegemony nowadays, at least in the sense that it was used before in some decades ago. Okay. Thank you.
Great. Questions there? Who'd like to go first? Philippe, go first.
Yes, well, I'm not sure to have catch all the points. I was wondering how to find a tube to go to Semper Plus because it appears that there is some problem. Sorry. About the question, what is changing, what is not changing about the role of culture? It was your point. Yeah, what has changed in what is important on the canon, or is it important that there are changes on the canon? I don't...
Both.
Well, difficult to answer. I think that one of the points that Mike, Laurie, and other colleagues have very highly emphasized in the handbook that they recently edited is the importance to tackle with this question in a non-substantialist way. That is to say that we have to think this question of cultural capital, cultural divide, cultural cleavages, in terms of in a relational way rather than in a substantial way. Definitely, I think that I will say that items might change, the definition of canon might change. But what we observe is that basically the underlying process remain quite the same. I cannot say more on that point at the moment, sorry.
I do think actually there are different forms of hybrid cultures nowadays, and I think there are more classical forms and more modern or contemporary form. And I also do think that the winners in this game, if there are winners, is those who actually can play with both. Who can listening to an opera and can play video games afterwards. So this who can combine, and this is the combination, that kind of combination that can help you to navigate through different social strata. Who can give you some social capital because you can know different people and also can navigate within different milieus. So that's what I think, really.
Thank you. I'll just start by trying to answer that the last question, which I thought was really interesting, this idea of sort of refusal to refuse as a form of indecision.
Plus being somehow sort of inconsistent.
I think indecision possibly isn't the right word because it implies weakness, possibly, or, for me, it's more a sort of deliberate or a calculated decision not to perhaps pin your stripes, you know, too clearly to particular objects, this is what I was trying to, and perhaps not very well, trying to illustrate in the last example, is that I think there is something about a moral sort of need or sense that of social acceptability to sort of not appear to be too clearly publicly demarcating one's sense of cultural sophistication. And so part of the perhaps being less tied down by particularly straightforward set of tastes and objects that one consumes and builds an identity around is partly about leaving one open to be able to play with different interactions and different interactions with different types of people that doesn't so clearly sort of distinguish oneself in that way. So for me, it's not necessarily indecision. I can't think of a word, but it's an. It's a sort of
It's an ideology.
Not being tied down, possibly. That's yeah. I'm sure I'll think of a better word at some point. the economic versus cultural capital question, just quickly. I mean, none of us have explored this. I don't think necessarily explicitly in our work. The interesting, there's Mike's done work that's shown that unlike other countries in Europe where people have tried to map Bourdieu's distinction and where they found a clear cultural capital composition axis, in the British sort of data, they didn't find that as clearly. And I wonder if that's something to do with the way in which particular sort of economic professions in the UK, things like banking or allied to that, still perhaps require, in a certain sense, certain forms of established cultural capital in order to make one's way in that domain, which would, in a way, sort of reduce the distinction to some extent. But if you're asking whether there is at all a distinction, I think there absolutely is, but I think there are probably differences to do with education systems and historically in different countries.
Just a couple of words. I think the questions raised are really, really important ones, and I think these are the kind of current issues. The point about what is the canon, the canon is still there in many ways, the traditional canon. It's just that it seems, and this comes out of work we did at the Cultural Capital Project several years ago, it has less excitement. So, you know, people still know Beethoven, they still know Mozart, but people don't get excited about it, certainly not young people, in the way that, you know, they might have done in previous decades. What gets people excited, and in Bourdieu's terms, what conveys the stakes and intensities is the contemporary stuff, which I think there is some shift there. But also, going back to the question about the global and the kind of cosmopolitan, in some nations in the world, you know, I think you can find, and I particularly think of a PhD student of mine, Maria Luisa Mendez, who did some work on Chile a number of years ago. Her argument was that in Chile, the big difference wasn't between kind of straightforward highbrow and middlebrow and lowbrow, it's between middle-class Chileans who look towards Europe for their cultural inspiration and those who look towards America. So it's because this kind of geographical frame of reference is more salient than just in a highbrow culture, whatever that is. And given the way in which American culture is often seen to be quintessentially popular culture, and European culture has historically been seen as kind of highbrow, but those terms are being remade, I think. So I think the issue of geographical reference points is overlapping with the issue about cultural hierarchy in interesting ways. One last round of questions, I think, if there's time.
I was interested in the influence of social media and the fact that we are encouraged, it seems, to express our interests and tastes far more frequently now and use cultural objects to kind of decorate our Facebook pages. And I feel like I'm constantly interrogated to name five good things. And I was just interested in whether this higher frequency of expressing cultural taste, is that feeding, is there any research or any thoughts on whether that's feeding back into perceptions of culture as a whole?
Question. Any two more?
Hi, thank you very much for your talk. I was just wondering, in terms of the omnivore argument, being an omnivore, isn't that just sort of an indirect form of distinction in itself? Because surely it's only sort of the dominant classes that can afford to that have the privilege of crossing those boundaries between highbrow and lowbrow. Yeah.
Yep. One more.
I have two.
Thanks, one more.
Hi, thank you for your talks. I was wondering if tech and how we use tech is an important part of cultural capital, and also things like social media, is there a hierarchy, have you found from your research, in how they're used and which ones are used by different people?
Thank you. Is there one, any more? Back there, yeah. Back.
Could you please comment on the tastemakers and their role in
in emerging forms of cultural capital, whether they have an increasingly important role or a waning role.
Good. Okay, that's the final round. I'm afraid Philippe has to leave for the Eurostar, but the three of us here will try and do our best. Laurie, do you want to catch that?
I have an East Coast to catch. Yeah, so omnivory is a new form of distinction. Yes, I fully agree. As I said, it's the crossing cultural boundaries to draw new social boundaries, so they kind of become distinctive and establish some status from that. So completely agree. But social media, I do think developing some knowledge in social media has become some sort of a form of new power, that new forms of power you can have on others, and especially in terms of age, a difference in age and generation. So you can think that if you know how to manipulate the media, and if you know how to build an efficient Twitter account or et cetera, that gives you some skills, and you can basically have the opportunity to be heard and become influential and et cetera. So I think this is definitely something that we shouldn't look at in the establishment of culture capital. And in terms of tastemaker, yes, I don't know if they are increasing. I don't really know about that, but what is sure is that, again, because of the social media, they have those who are important have definitely great social exposure. Sometimes not the best one, but also you have people who become some sort of who become emblematic of new changes. And to go back to the idea of different forms of eyebrows, I was thinking of an example. I was listening to Francesco Tristano the other day, and he's a fantastic classic pianist, trained at the Juilliard School, very famous in New York, but now he's doing electro music, and he's actually combining piano and electro music, and he's really kind of a symbol of how to emerge established and emerging forms of culture capital, and I think in that way he's acting as a tastemaker.
Yeah, thanks for the question. I'm thinking about the one about tastemakers. Wrote about this a little bit in relation to comedy, where I think a bit like Motti Regev, Laurie mentioned, tastemakers were hugely important in terms of creating a discourse for rock music that actually sort of made it legitimate. Similar, I think, in relation to comedy to some extent in the role of comedy criticism as a way of sort of legitimating it as an art form for the middle classes to start talking about and enjoying. I think the question of whether they're becoming more or less is, again, very hard for us to sort of answer empirically. I suppose, you know, in an age where notions of sort of like the critical authority of one or certain people is challenged by the way in which people can express opinions about cultural performances. I'm thinking about the Edinburgh Fringe, for instance, where still I think people use critics very much to decide what to do, but forms of more sort of bottom-up forms of criticism from audience members are actually becoming increasingly powerful in terms of driving audiences, word of mouth, and I suppose the internet facilitates that. So that might be some indication, but I think that is sort of an empirical question. Mike, do you have any?
Let's respond to a couple of things. One of them is about technology, which also overlaps with the issue about social media and things. I mean, I think there's something very important here, which is that, again, when Bourdieu was writing, you know, the intellectual class was predominantly a kind of class which was trained in the humanities, was trained in history and philosophy and literature, art, music. Those were the kind of disciplinary domains which defined high taste. Over the last, well, particularly the last 50 years, we've seen this rise of technical expertise across whole swathes of social and cultural life. And I do think, trying to understand what is sometimes called technical capital, but I'm not sure that's the best phrase, but people who've got skills from computer programming and IT and stuff, we need to take that into account. So people are often getting their cultural kudos these days from those kinds of mechanisms, I think, as much as referring back to the humanities, which can be seen as a bit old hat.
I also want to go back to this issue about economic capital too, which was partly raised over here, but I think it's also linked into the kind of debates, bigger debates, because Bourdieu famously talks about economic capital, social capital, and cultural capital. And one way of thinking about what's happening today might be partly that what the social media allow is social capital to have more power relative to cultural capital, because part of the thing going on is kind of who you know, and the number of people you know in one form or another can be expanded using the social media. So whether actually the cultural, one's cultural activities are being more folded back into social capital, our friendships and our networks is, I think, an interesting issue. Then also on this point, which goes on to the economic capital issue, I have been very influenced by, you know, Piketty's argument, which is not a million miles away from Bourdieu, but he's saying over the last 30 years there's been this big accumulation of economic capital. So when Bourdieu was writing, economic capital, wealth, savings, was much lower than it has become. And if and that trend is apparent in many, many nations, including the UK, particularly starkly, the logic of that is to say, well, therefore, in today's world, economic capital is likely to count for much more vis-a-vis cultural capital than was the case 50 years ago. And hence, it is the big, and also links into the kind of taste makers argument. I mean, who are the big taste makers in music? Arguably, it's not the publicly funded music services. It is the private companies and the people who run, who and the private interest groups which run popular music. So, you know, there could be a very important shift in the balance between economic, cultural, and social capital, according to which ones have been accumulating most rapidly. And in that area, economic capital is very, you know, powerful and increasingly powerful. Google, Facebook, Twitter. These are all very wealthy, affluent private companies, and they're having a key influence these days. Okay, I think that's enough. Thank you very much
for
your questions.
Thank you.
And thank you for coming.